I'm going to start talk giving like some motivations about, I mean, we already saw Jupyter notebooks from several presentations now. We saw one showing in the very beginning. She was calling code from the Jupyter notebooks and showing things in Napari. Then Peter briefly also opened a few Jupyter notebooks, and then Robert was also showing how to export a workflow into a Jupyter notebook, and then you were already executing some cells. I just wanted to start giving like some motivations why we do that. So in image analysis and also in other fields, there is this classic software view versus the notebook view. So imagine sometimes that you have a workflow which is done by this piece of code here. And this was how it has always been, like you maybe have this Python code and then you just run it. And then you can, for example, open a terminal and then maybe run it there. And then this workflow would run and the outputs would be saved into some folder in your computer. And that looks very good. And then sometimes some window will pop up showing some intermediate results, and that all occurs sort of instantaneously. And that's okay. Also some graphs perhaps. But sometimes this may be a bit confusing to know what's actually the code is actually doing. So the advantage of using Jupyter notebooks is that the code is divided into smaller parts that you can execute step by step. So as you, it's also very dynamic because you can run cells individually. It's like you run a piece of code and then usually you print some results just afterwards. And besides that, it has rich output. So it's different from this popping windows or that you, or just code where you can write some comments explaining what's happening. Here you can also write some texts like with titles and bold letters, and basically you can also describe what's happening. So that's very good for reproducibility in science of your workflow, because people can see piece by piece how it works, they can read it, they can understand. And then, yes, so they'll have code plus formatted text, so that's an easy way to document your workflow. So what's a Jupyter notebook? It's nothing very special about it. It's basically a text file stored in your computer that allows, but also you can basically run this file and then run Python code from it. So it's rendered by Jupyter in the browser. It's split into this section called cells, and then you can run them individually. And each cell may contain, as you can see in this example, like some piece of Python code, or maybe there are also other language supported. You can have formatted text, as I mentioned, which is the markdown cell type. And you can also have what we call rich output. You can display some images there. You already saw some screenshots from Napari being shown in the Jupyter notebook. So it's useful for documenting our workflow, of course, for publications, to share with others, but also for your future self, because sometimes you execute some code and then, I don't know, 3 months later already, or maybe a year later, you're going to revisit that code. What was happening there? I don't remember. And then if you have that in a Jupyter notebook, you can execute step by step. Maybe if you wrote some markdown cells explaining what's happening, it's much easier for you, for others to understand what you did, and also for you to remember what you did in the past. So for example, you may find in some papers the methods describing, so first we applied a Gaussian filter from second image with sigma equal 1. Then we applied another filter to the original image. So this could be like a methods description of a paper. Okay, that's fine. They are describing each step of the workflow. On the other hand, this is much more readable. So you can say, so the workflow is explained in this notebook. Of course, you can still describe it in the text if you like, but then maybe you can not give so much details because the Jupyter notebook is basically explaining the workflow for you. And you can provide that as a complementary file, for example, showing the data is available and the code is available. That would be good for open science. And then, yes, so as I said, this is like a file that you can send around, and then there are some renderers that can display it. So the one that you're mainly be using is Jupyter Lab. So you're going to be rendering the notebook locally and running the cell locally. There are other options. You can also, if you send this notebook to GitHub, as we did for the material for this course, of course, if you open this notebook in the GitHub page, you also see it nicely rendered. Of course, there you cannot run these cells because it doesn't have Python there, but you can see it at least and read it, and you can save the outputs that you previously from a previously run notebook. There's also this NB viewer. It's another way to render, visualize your notebooks. And of course, if you have Jupyter Lab, you can render them and run them in Python. And another option is Google Colab. So they have their own version of displaying these notebooks. And there you can also execute these notebooks on the cloud. So it's a service that Google provides for free. And yes, you have to accept the terms, and then you can also send notebooks there and then run the cells there as well. Also, notebooks are useful for teaching. So currently the situation, like we use, you notice that, or you will notice soon that we provided many of this course material in the form of Jupyter notebooks. And then you can also, like, as I said, re-execute step by step and see the intermediate results. It's easier to understand. That's like a full script like this, that you can print some stuff or pop up some images. It's probably better to see some explanations and then the commands a bit more separated. Yes. And then also, when you are using Jupyter Notebooks, you keep all the benefits from using code. It's mainly allowing you to do batch processing more easily. So as soon as you've done your workflow, for example, trying out in Napari of the assistant or some other tool, maybe there are some plugins that allow you to do batch processing, others don't. So it depends on the developer. And actually, Python is very good at doing that. So if you have a function, you see by the end of today or beginning of tomorrow, that if you have a function that contains your workflow there, you could put it in a loop and run this function for many files in a folder. And that's you're already doing batch processing. Python is a native for those kinds of things. And then, yes, so it allows you to do more easily batch processing. Also allows you to run Python functions that may be still unavailable in plugins. So the Python ecosystem is, of course, much bigger than Napari plugins. So it's nice if we have some plugins because they are easy to use. They're much more interactive at first. But Jupyter notebooks are also quite well interactive. And maybe you can find like this nice Python function that just does what you need to do, but you just cannot use it as a plugin yet because there's no plugin. So you can call it by code and then at least having the possibility of using it. And if you know a bit better, maybe you'll turn this into a plugin in the future. Okay, well, who knows? So, and now I would say, like, why then using notebooks with Napari? So as I mentioned, Juan in the very first day already showed you how you can control Napari from Jupyter Notebooks. And maybe if you change things in the viewer, you can also get results back in the code. So it's a nice interaction of data from the notebook to Napari. The Napari developers really thought that from the very beginning. And as you saw, it's great for visualizing 3D and higher dimensional data. And each processing step can display it as a separate layer. So yes, you can also do a processing step, just as we saw with the assistant. That's a new layer, it's your new result. Then you can keep building your workflow step by step. And also it was shown both by Juan and Robert that you can annotate some things in Napari. For example, you can annotate some points there manually. You can draw some segmentations, manual segmentations yourself, either to use with machine learning or maybe just to do like a ground truth. It's your manual annotations in some cases. So it depends. In this case, Napari, it's easier to do this data annotation than plain Jupyter notebooks. So you can do an annotation in Napari, for example, and then you get the results from the annotation back into the Jupyter notebook, and you can continue there. Yes, so, I mean, this was like, I hope I can convince you a bit about why we are suggesting and to use JupyterLab, but also the other flexibility that you have with programming with Python. And now I would like to start like properly showing how to open JupyterLab with the environment that we created for this course, and then running some basic cells there. Of course, by now I think you already did that, but still, here's like a brief explanation how one could do it. So as we showed in the beginning, let me just put this pointer laser. Yes. So you may start with the prompt, the command prompt, and then you should activate the environment that we created for this course. Later on, you activate the environment that you're using in your project. And then if you have the necessary packages installed, in this case, you should have, then you just type after activating Jupyter space lab, and this should open like a new tab on your browser with Jupyter lab. And then just pay attention that in the very beginning, usually you have the current environment that you are, and usually followed by that, you have your current path. So in my case, I'm in Windows, so just this is the path where I'm currently opening my Jupyter lab from. You may want to navigate to a different folder. I will show this live soon as well. As soon as you type Jupyter lab, as I said, this tab will open. And then you may have some here on the very left, you can see like all the files that you have in this current path. And then see here I have, for example, in this example, many untitled Jupyter notebooks, which is not very good. You should rename your Jupyter notebooks to something that you can remember what they are. But anyways, then here you can easily create an empty new Jupyter notebook by clicking on this Python 3 icon. Once you do that, then you have a new tab system, which is like here. So here you are in your browser. And then inside of this tab, you have your Jupyter lab opened. And then inside of your Jupyter lab, you can open multiple notebooks, like in these new tabs here. And you can easily run Python commands by typing some Python commands in these cells and then clicking on this little play button here, or just pressing shift enter, then whatever cell is selected is going to be executed. It may be also very interesting, especially in the beginning, to start typing some commands that you may think, okay, I want to do print, and then you start typing P, and then you press tab for auto completion. So Jupyter Lab has some options to try to autocomplete with the command you're looking for. Then you can select and press enter or tab, and then you have like this command. You may also wonder like what does this command do? And then you may also, once you've chose one, you can try adding this little question mark and then executing that cell. What that will do, it will print this function docstring. So docstrings are like little a sequence, a text that you put, that developers put in the very beginning of their functions, basically describing what this function does. So if you're using a function that's well documented, you should have like an explanation of what it does, what parameters it can accept, and etc. So I encourage you to always try that out if you don't know what that does. Of course, you could also Google online and or use any other tool. But here you can just give it a try locally. Also, as I said, it's important to rename your notebooks. So as soon as you create one, you see it's going to be Untitled 31, and then try to rename it already. Don't wait to do that later. Already rename it to something that you will know what it does later. Yes, so give it a new name. And then once you're done, you can click on this shutdown button here from the file menu, and that will like shut down the Jupyter Lab kernel. And then you have your terminal back live. And this tab will stay there, but it's going to be unresponsive. So you can just close it. If you accidentally close the tab, that's fine. You can also restart the terminal completely. So that's no big harm, but that would be the proper way to shut down an open Jupyter Lab session. So then I would say also it's a good practice that after you run some Python in the Jupyter notebook, always try to come here to kernel and then click on restart kernel and run all cells before you leave. Because you know that by the end of the day, so this will run the notebook, it will restart and run the notebook from top to bottom, all cells. And then you should have a working version from top to bottom. Because I'll show you in a bit that there is a tricky thing about Jupyter notebooks that you may already have noticed. You can execute the cells out of order. And that's fine while you're still trying things out. But then by the end of the day, if you have something very big that's working, but then you executed this and then the third and then the second, you will not remember that. So it's good that you do this restart and run all cells before you close your notebook. So you know that these things are working well in sequence. So your workflow is working fine. Yes, always try to have a clean execution state. Because also, if, for example, if you send this notebook, so look, you have an ES workflow, you send somebody else, and then they'll try to run it and say, oh, there are errors here, what's going on? And then, you have to execute this and here. So always try to see for yourself if your cells work from top to bottom, like in the right order.